Hey guys, it's Tim, and this is HN Annotated. One of the big sticking points for fans going into the new Venom movie is its, and by extension all of Sony films, seeming lack of connection to Spider-Man. It's certainly a valid concern considering how much Venom's character and history are wrapped into Spider-Man. And this is both the symbiote and Eddie Brock. It's certainly possible to tell a Venom story without Spider-Man, but completely removing the two from each other feels disingenuous to the mythos. With that said, despite the fact that Spider-Man will likely not feature in the Venom film, there are a number of options for how the two could meet in another film down the line. Sony has been making Spider-Man films since 2002, and with them they've built up quite a few potential options of Spider-Men that Venom could interact with. Right off the bat though, we can remove the Tobey Maguire version from being in the running. Say what you want about Spider-Man 3, it's still part of that Spider-Man story. Considering that Venom was already introduced there, as was Eddie Brock, there really isn't an opening for an entirely new version of a character and origin. So Tobey's version is out, but that still gives us three more options of existing Spider-Man. They could set Venom in the webverse with Andrew Garfield. While the Amazing Spider-Man films were a mixed bag, they were cut off very short with only two films, and right when they were just starting to expand that universe. They had plans for Black Cat with Felicity Jones, they were setting up the Sinister Six for their own film, and there were even plans of that version being the one that showed up in the MCU at some point. Obviously that fell through, but if they truly wanted to keep the Venomverse separate from the MCU so that Sony can do more of their own thing with these films, but still wanted to have Spider-Man, why not brush off the old universe? While Amazing Spider-Man 2 didn't wow people, the Andrew Garfield version of the character still has his fans, so people likely wouldn't complain too much with bringing him back. Plus, if there's one thing that DC has done well, it's getting audiences used to multiple versions of the same character having on-screen appearances at the same time. One of the major factors against this, though, is that it's not clear if Andrew Garfield left the role on good terms. So it's not certain if he'd be inclined to come back even if they wanted to go in that direction. Which brings us to the current movie Spider-Man, Tom Holland, who's currently swinging about in the MCU. This is largely going to be reliant on two things. A, whether Sony wants their films to be in the MCU, which would mean they would have to follow stricter guidelines with how their universe progresses, and B, if Marvel wants to have the Sony films as part of their universe, meaning that a product would be added to it that they may not necessarily have direct oversight in. With that being said though, this is the most likely option for a crossover. Not only is this the current on-screen version of Spider-Man, but despite the films being part of the MCU, Sony still co-produces and has oversight over them. In fact, it's up to Sony to decide what Spider-Man characters can appear in the MCU, especially which ones can appear outside of Spider-Man films. If Sony wanted to use this version of the character, they seem to have the complete ability to do so. Many of the people behind the film, especially Tom Holland himself, have expressed an interest in doing this, though, of course, nothing has been confirmed. But if they did use Tom Holland, then that would firmly set the Venom film in the MCU, and give us an old-fashioned Tom H showdown. But Tom Holland isn't the only version of Spider-Man to appear on movie screens this year, because we have our final choice for an established film Spider-Man to tie into this film, Jake Johnson. Yes, he's playing an animated version of the character, but it's still from Sony, though their animation department, and it gives you the opportunity to flesh out that particular Peter's universe by having it be the new Sony Venomverse. This means that not only will it be giving more information on that animated Peter's world, but also means that Sony would be establishing more of an entire Spider-Verse. From a physicality standpoint, Jake Johnson is a bit off from matching Spider-Man, but if the film is focusing on Venom anyway, there's really no need to show the Peter Parker side and you could just still make it a voice role. Plus it gives fans who wanted an older live-action Spider-Man something to make them happy while Tom Holland does his thing in the MCU. Outside of those options, Sony could just make a new Spider-Man for the Venomverse. It's the cleanest option, but with two other Spider-Men on screen this year alone, it could be overkill for the amount of Peter Parkers we have. We went through a clone saga back in the 90s, we don't need to relive it again. If I had my choice, I'd push for Tom Holland. Not only is he my favorite live-action Spider-Man to date, but I also like interconnectivity. So if they could pull to have Venom be a part of the MCU, even tangentially, that'd be the option I gun for. But what about you guys? Do you think that they could have Spider-Man show up in the Venomverse movies? And which version of the character would you like to see, an existing one or a new one? Well, as always, let us know down in the comments, but until next time, I've been Tim, and this is HN Annotated.